Before they tell me what to do, my work boss brought me back in a perfect iambic trimeter, but break the first and last lines. Regarding the inverted foot, which begins the first line, some critics say Frost hadn't found his rhythm yet. Regarding the truncated or unfinished foot that begins the line 8, some critics have suggested that Frost was sloppy. While these explanations may be perfectly correct, other scholars have posited explanations that far better serve the felix culpa theme. Lines 1 and 8 are the only lines that contain stressed first symbol. So we can see here in bold, the very first syllable is stressed, and both of these syllables are the same sound, N. This consistency binds the two halves of the poem together and suggests the cyclical nature of loss, love, and gratitude inherent and implied in Frost's nature metaphor. The mirror-like or symmetrical nature of these two lines is so obvious, one can almost envision the ancient Ouroboros or Ouroboros symbol as a physical representation of them. That's this ancient symbol we see of a serpent eating its own tail. The fact that life is renewing, or in this case, I guess it's a dragon, not a serpent, but life is renewing and recycling, and what goes around kind of comes around. So we can see that because both of them begin with and end with stressed syllables. Notice that each one of these lines, these are the only two lines in all eight lines that begin and end with stressed syllables. Beginning stressed, end with stressed syllables. So they have a cyclical nature. They are both respectively, they introduce and conclude the theme. So nature's first green is gold, introduces the theme, while nothing gold can stay, concludes, or provides the solution for the theme. And they are both introduced by the same sound, as we've already said, and they both work together to contain the other six lines of the poem, each of which is perfect iambic trimeter. Both lines 1 and 8 are also the only lines that contain the word gold. Although they both contain the word gold, the meaning of the metaphor is changed by line 8. In the first line, the metaphor simply suggests preciousness or the precious nature of hope and early spring. By line 8, gold takes on a whole different meaning. As the reader traverses through the poem, he witnesses the speaker's comprehension undergo a transformation. While the opening quatrain suggests immaturity and morbidity, the second quatrain suggests growth and understanding, and this mostly comes from line 6, "So Eden sank to grief." The reference to humankind's fall and the following understanding that morning turns to night, or day, and day to night, and back again, suggests an appreciation and understanding of the inevitable nature of the universe. It is as if the speaker now understands, oh, of course, nothing gold can stay. By the end of the poem, gold could be a metaphor for innocence, paradise, hope, love, or even humankind itself. Again, lines 1 through 8 work together to both contain and sustain the poem's true theme.